Good afternoon once again, and welcome to the second webinar of this day in the 2023 IHF Youth Coaches Education Week, where leading experts throughout the world of handball share their knowledge and experience in 7 days. We had one webinar prior to this. We saw how Germany develops its youth talent, and we will continue also in Germany with another very interesting webinar. My name is Adrian Costeu. I'm a member of the IHF media team, and I will be your host throughout all this week in the IHF Youth Coaches Education Week. And of course, we have translations available because this webinar is in English. Just click the globe icon, the interpretation icon at the bottom of your Zoom app. There are translations available in French, Spanish, and Arabic. And of course, you can rewatch all these webinars at ihfeducation.ihf.info. So access this, that page, and you will, of course, be able to watch on demand all webinars in the IHF Education Center. Without much further ado, we have a very interesting topic presented by Jochen Beppler, an IHF lecturer and the assistant coach of Germany women's senior national team. The theme is isolation spaces for successful one-on-ones, duels. How can trends from top handball be transferred to the next generation in youth handball? So, of course, very interesting topic. Jochen, the floor is yours, please.
Thank you so much, Adrian, and welcome to all of you all around the globe. Adrian already introduced the topic of today's lecture. And I'm happy to present this topic to you because I was already lecturing about this in June in the last IHF Education Week. And as Adrian already said, I'm assistant coach for the women's team, but I'm also responsible for our younger age category teams. So that is why I strongly feel committed to prepare the next generation in handball. And my colleague Patrick Luik prepared the floor somehow for me with his topic of long-term athlete development. And at the end of the presentation, please feel free to put and to ask questions. And I will start with the topic of isolations, as we did in June, just to make clear what I consider to be an isolation. Before I will strongly focus on the younger age category teams, how this looks in those ages to prepare those players for the next generation of top players, and also how this could look like in practice as well. So after an introduction, we will focus on the structure of isolations. Then we will have a look at one of the events of this summer, the European Youth Olympic Festival, which took place in Slovenia in Maribor, and there prepared some clips for you. And then we will focus on what does it need as necessary technical demands and physical skills, and also some exercises, how this could be developed in practice. And as I said at the end, please feel free to ask questions. So those of the participants who took part in June already have seen this part, what is an isolation, but as a reminder or as an introduction for today's lecture, it's still worth dealing with this once again. If you want, you can also use this QR code to see a clip taken out of the Olympic Games 2021 in the match of Egypt against Denmark. But you can also watch it here online. I hope the quality is good enough. So here you see the scene, which we are going to focus afterwards in closer details. Here we see it in the slow motion and from a different angle and perspective. A nice goal by Mats Mensah. And we will look at the clip in different points of time, different sequences. First of all, we saw a long run-up by Mats Mensa to create a high speed, to have an advantage for a possible one-on-one or his shot. And then we also see the line player standing between the two central defenders, which makes it easy for the defense to cooperate. And they are able to cooperate because they can really communicate well on who is responsible for which of the two players. This changes in the next picture when we see Mats Mensa with a change of rhythm and speed, developing the speed by bouncing the ball once, and also with the line player moving away and making it more difficult for the defense to cooperate and creating a larger space for Mats Mensa and his one-on-one. We can see this in the next picture. We see the defender number three of Egypt is not prepared for this following duel. And that is why Mats Mensa, coming with high speed, is able to decide for the best option whether to have a shot, a one-on-one, or a cooperation with a line player or one of his backcourt colleagues. All of this happens in a pretty large space. This looks not as large as it will look from a different angle, as we saw in the slow motion. Here it looks smaller than it is in reality. But from this perspective, you can see the whole sequence once again, the long run-up of Mats Mensa and the defenders able to cooperate in this situation. Then the bouncing and changing of rhythm. The line player has already moved away. So one of the defenders is following him. The other one is isolated. And here you can see that the space for the one-on-one is quite big to have a one-on-one or a shot, because the defender is not able to block this shot by Mats Mensa. So, and as I said, a large space to solve this task. So, and then it's for very good players quite easy to solve this situation if they are prepared, if they have been trained well, if they have acquired all the necessary techniques for this situation. Once again, we can see what we mean by an isolation in the central sector, with a line player moving away and opening large space for a one-on-one. And so we come to the final summary, to the repetition. What do we mean by an isolation? What's the definition, key elements or characteristics? We try to create large space, the larger the better, but the smaller the space is, the more you need precision in your technical performance. The defense can hardly or can't even cooperate, especially helping or decision-making situations are quite difficult. And a consequence is a one-on-one duel with an advantage for the attacker, because he comes with a huge dynamic caused by the long run-up. The defender reacts out of a defensive position because he was not prepared whether he should defend the line player or he's going to defend the backcourt player. Often we find specialists or go-to guys for those one-on-one situations in attack, and maybe also against one of the weak defenders. So the target sector in which we find those isolations is most of the time hidden for a long time by different means or openings in attack. The importance of line players has been mentioned during the last years, because he is not only helping the backcourt players by putting blocks, but he's also preparing space for one-on-one duels. And so the importance of line players has increased during the last years because we face more and more isolations in handball. So here we have the summary. We have a long run-up for the attacker because the defender reacts out of a defensive position because the line player is standing in the same sector. The moving line player, or pivot, as some countries call the line player, destroys the cooperation in defense by moving away. So the defender reacts quite late and from a defensive position. We create large space for attack. And sometimes we have some camouflage situations or camouflage actions in which the target sector and the constellation of duel is hidden or created at a very late point of time. Second, let's have a look at the structure of isolations, because we can approach isolations depending on different focuses. So we have possible structures depending on the focus. If you want to focus on the defender you want to attack, you can ask yourself the question, which of the defenders do I want to attack with which player in attack? Do you prefer central or half defenders? Maybe also the question might arise for you, where are the strengths and weaknesses of your opponent? So the approach here is led by the questions the knowledge you have about your opponent's defenders. Second approach could be, do you have a specialist for duels or a specialist who is able to make quick decisions? So who is your go-to guy that you want to have in that duel? So you have to think about some special openings to get this player in the target sector. So, and a third approach, how do you hide important information for your opponent? You could have different openings or a general opening with variations. In June, I showed some examples of Brazil, who tried to attack the half defender, and they had a general opening with a wing transition, but with variations in their following up actions, like crossings or transitions. Yeah, and another opportunity or another possibility to hide important information is to hide or to create the personal constellation in the target sector very lately. So these are possible structures, and you can also put this into a picture or a graphic, which starts with a different opening actions. I usually call them the big five, like crossings without ball, crossing of center back and pivot, transition of wings, crossing in the backs, or a central opening in the central sector with a two against two. So with the opening action, you can hide the target sector. As we said, it's a camouflage action. And you create the target constellation of the players who are going to play the one-on-one or the defender you want to attack. Second question here in silver, you have to ask yourself, which defender do I want to attack? The central defender or the half defenders, number two or five? And do you have a following up action which is intended, or does it happen just in the situation? So it depends on the creativity and the flexibility of your players. Strongly connected to the sector and the defender you are attacking is also that you can make use of different pivot actions, like the line player moving away. The line player moving away only in a fake situation, but coming back. You will see this in some examples. Or using the line player for a block at a central defender to the outside. So three different opportunities. And last, not least, the last stage, which is more important for the high performance and the senior categories, and it's not that important for developing young players, the variations and fakes, like a fake retransition or a fake isolation, which ends up in a 2-against-2. I think for developing players, it's important to focus more on the silver part of this graphic, and maybe also the golden part, so that they learn we can isolate a central defender by different openings. But the blue part with trick plays is more important for senior categories. Let's focus on today's topic, younger age categories. As I said, I want to show you some clips of the European Youth Olympic Festival in Slovenia, in Maribor. And Patrick Luik showed you also and already some clips why this is important for a long-term athlete development, and also how this is connected to athletics and preparing the players in different kinds than only the technical or the tactical part. So this is my job in this afternoon session, to focus on the technical part and the tactical part. What I want to show you first is a clip which is intended to isolate number two defender. The clips are taken of a under 17 competition. So you see players born in the year 2006 and 2007. First, you can see this clip, and then I will show the clip once again with some animated screen for you to figure out what is important from my point of view. Let's look at the first clip. So what is less important, but was shown in the golden sector, we have an opening action with crossing of center back and the line player coming back into the sector of number two defender, and then he's moving away. So keep in mind, we want to isolate number two defender. This was in the silver box. This is the intention. And we did this by the opening of a crossing of center back and the line player. Let's look at the scene and the clip once again. And from now on, you can see an animated screen of the players who are important. Number nine is the player who is going to play the duel, the one-on-one. And the line player is coming back from his crossing, and he will help to create a large space by moving out of this sector to prepare a large space for a one-on-one. And the attacker is coming in a long run-up to have an advantage for the one-on-one. So he's winning this duel to his strong side. And the central defender number three decides too late that his aid is needed, that his help is needed. And so number nine of Germany can win this duel and has a breakthrough ending by a penalty. Next situation. Again, number two defender is isolated, but we also see some help of the left wing. He's assisting to keep number two defender in a defensive position. Let's look at the clip and how this looks like. So first of all, what is different? We have an isolation or an intended isolation of number two defender, but we have a different opening. So this is different in this clip, different opening, but the same intention. And we have the left wing also being in the target sector to keep the defender in a defensive position. Here you can see this with animated screen. So both a left wing and line player are moving away, creating large space, and the left back is not able to win this one-on-one to his weak side. And so the continue of the play is a free throw. Next clip, again, isolation of number two defender. And let's look what happens in this clip. So we have the same situation. It's a crossing of right back and right wing to prepare a faster passing of the ball to get the ball to the left backcourt player for his duel in a high dynamic. But what you can see in the clip is that the defender number two is already in the know that he's going to be isolated, that he has to play this duel. And so he's defending out of the 9 meter area and destroying the long run up of left back. And here you can see that there's also something to learn for center back in this situation, because if we have the left wing inside and the number two defender is moving out too early because he's already anticipating the one-on-one, we maybe need a completely different solution of center back. So if number two defender is out too early, we can have a fake movement of left wing and coming back behind number two defender. Because if the line player has also moved away, we would have an easy pass for center back to the left wing, standing behind number two defender. And so this is something where center back could also learn, the players involved can also learn easy solutions if the defenders are reacting too early, anticipating a one-on-one. Okay, then we are moving to the next category of clips, isolation of number three defender. What is important, most important of all, is that the backcourt players always have to be dangerous and able to shoot. This is the first solution they should have in mind, not to play in an egoistic way, but to do what they are supposed to do, which is being dangerous, because only those players who have the ball can be dangerous. So let's look at this clip. It almost looks like the situation of Mats Mensah, who did this with a bouncing of the ball, but here number 14 of Germany receives the ball from the left backcourt player. And what he is doing very, very good is that he is running in high speed, that he is not looking for the pass first, but that he is looking for his own chance, because by doing this, he attracts the attention of the defender. And is taking over responsibility to be dangerous. Once again. So the defender is in a defensive situation, and then left back of Germany is taking this quick step shot. So a very good solution. And he can rely on his technical skills of having a good step shot. And this is what we should have in mind as youth coaches, as those who are responsible for developing players for the next generation, that it's not something extraordinary which we have to teach and to develop them, but that it's first of all basic skills in a high precision, in high and good quality. And that is why my colleague Patrick also referred to this as a long-term development, and that on this high quality and high precision in technical skills, we build up on athletic skills as well, and not on the third, fourth, or fifth tactical solution of a situation. Okay, let's go to the next clip, and you will see that I decided for many clips to show you different solutions for the same tactical situation. And this is what I think is important as well. If we are able to create the same tactical situation and have players who are flexible and have the skills to solve this easy situation in different ways, then we have done a good job. And here you can also see that the coaches of Jan, that's the player on left back, in his clubs have done a great job in developing those skills for him, because here he solves the situation with a one-on-one to his strong side. Here he does not receive the pass. Here he does a bouncing, changes his rhythm, and then he is attacking number three defender and wins the one-on-one to his strong side. Once again. Here he has gained the advantage. And you see that it needs responsibility not to look to the line player too quick. And you also see that it needs athletic skills to win this one-on-one, to be able to shoot also with body contact. But it's a nice situation where we have a simple situation and are able to solve this in different ways. Let's look at the same situation. We are isolating number four defender, the second central defender, for a left-handed player who's also going to his strong side. Once again. Oh no, I don't have a slow motion for this clip, I see. But then we can look at this again to also focus on the line player assisting to create large space, the right back having a long run-up with a high speed and an advantage for that one-on-one. And also very good action of the Hungarian goalkeeper in this situation. So now we have seen two situations where the players solve this one-on-one to the strong side. Let's also look at a scene where they solve the same situation with a one-on-one to the weak side. Here we have already the next situation. I have to stop this. Yeah, one-on-one to the weak side. And now, similar situation. And here you can see what I was mentioning about line player actions. This is a fake movement of the line player. He was faking to have that isolation, but now he is returning in the same space, which is created behind defender number three. And the attacker makes use of this fake movement of the line player because he's followed by defender number four. And so there's an advantage to his strong side, not against defender number three, but to his strong side in general, because number four defender is moving with the line player. And that is why left back can use this situation for a breakthrough, earning a penalty and a suspension for the Icelandic defender. So here we have a different attacker of Germany, also playing one-on-one to the weak side. And after having seen all those clips, we can sum up that the backcourt player should be able to solve the situations individually, which means a good shot, a good breakthrough, a good one-on-one to the strong side and to the weak side. And if they are able to do this and the defense is able to solve this, to make good helping decisions, to anticipate the one-on-one, giving early body contact, taking away the dynamic, then we have to be able to teach them cooperations with the line player or the pivot, but not telling them if you don't win the one-on-one, you can also play with the line player. But first of all, we have to make them strong individually. At least this is our and my philosophy. So let's look how a cooperation with the line player could look like. Okay, this was the one-on-one to the strong side with not that much space for a breakthrough or a good shot. And that is why number 14 of Germany decides for a cooperation with the line player who is waiting in the indirect block at number five defender, at the half defender. So first of all, we have a large distance between the three defenders, which you can see in this animated screen. And you can also see the line player waiting in an indirect block and in a very good position according to his feet and to his.
Jochen, I think your connection froze a bit. We can hear you now. You need to unmute yourself.
Okay, thank you, Adrian.
Perfect. Thank you. And you can now start sharing again and see what slide you were on.
Okay. Sorry for that. But thanks for your assistance, because I was still in my presentation.
No, it just you just froze and then you were out, and now we can see it again. So perfect.
So the whole world is seeing.
Yes. Perfect.
Okay. So we stopped at this slide with the cooperation of left back and the line player. And I stopped here where I said we have a large space and a large distance between the three defenders, but number four defender is going to help. And what we can see here is that the line player of Germany is waiting in a perfect position according to the distance of his feet, according to the part of his body, and according to his preparedness for receiving the pass of the backcourt player with his right hand. So this is what we can see perfect in this screen. He is awaiting that pass. And so a very good cooperation of left back and line player. Then we see an isolation of number three defender and a fake movement of the line player and a cooperation. In some clips ago, some clips before, I showed you that the that the backward player made use of this fake movement by having the breakthrough on his own and earning a penalty and suspension. But here he's making use of that fake movement and he's cooperating with the line player. So also this clip with animations. Okay, so we have seen different solutions now, individually and also in cooperation. And here we have fake movement of the line player and a fake cooperation. So very a good flexibility in easy situations. And once again, this is what I think is important for developing the next generation of players, not to have 20 solutions, but to have the solutions in individual and cooperative skills to be prepared for their next steps in their career. So we saw this clip, fake movement and fake cooperation, earning the penalty and the suspension. So here the fake pass, which is also important to teach players at young age categories, that they are good in feinting. Feinting is not only in body feint in one-on-one, but feinting is also having shot feints or pass feints. And this is what we saw here. So we also see this with another player in a different constellation of players. So this is not only that one player is able to do that, but that it is part of teaching the players. And here you can also see what could be a following up action. We can move on to this part again when number 9 of Germany is having or preparing that breakthrough here. And number 5 defender, the half defender, is helping. So we would need right back for a breakthrough in the sector between defenders number 5 and 6. But he is anticipating a cross. So you can see that this is the next step in their development, that we prepare different or intended following up actions, because sometimes the speed for players in this age category is too high to react spontaneously. But this is not bad from my point of view, but nevertheless, I wanted to draw your attention to this movement of our right back player here, while the movement into the space between number 5 and 6 would have been the better solution. So, and once again, isolation of number 2 defender with a different opening. The wing is coming inside, and then we have an isolation of number 2 defender. So keep in mind, it's the same which we started with, but with a different opening. What I like about this clip, if you watch the left backcourt player, he was not prepared to play that one-on-one, but he realized in the game, and then he gave a signal to the line player to move away to the outside, to become the new left wing, if you want to say it in this way. And then he's playing the one-on-one against number two defender. And this was not intended at the beginning, but this is what I like when I see that the players realize possible solutions for themselves. You can look at the left back. He's telling them to move away. And then he's playing that one-on-one to his weak side. So these were making clear what I consider to be important for isolations in younger age categories, some examples of that tournament in Slovenia in July. And now let's do one step back, that we also have to ask ourselves and focus on how do we develop, what is necessary to develop the demanding technical and physical skills. How can we develop this in younger age categories? Often coaches and colleagues ask themselves, or we are discussing together, with which skills should I start? My experience and my advice would be focus on the core. Don't focus on the second or the third solution and the technical skills you need for the second or for the third solution, but focus on the first solution and reduce complexity. Practice in the target sector and not in a general space, but practice in the target sector and focus on the core, focus on solution number one. Create exercises or spaces that can be solved with basic individual and cooperative tools. So the basic techniques are shooting, passing, and one-on-one. So, and one step after another, try to increase speed and to improve precision so that we have easy solutions with a better precision and with higher quality with every single practice. And the last step for this advice, that we teach our players or make them think themselves what are possible exits if they don't win duels. What are possible cooperations? But as I already said, only focus on maximum the next two possible solutions. Reduce as much as possible, improve the basic skills, and only focus on the next two possible solutions, maybe the pass to a line player or the pass to a colleague in the backcourt. Here I've prepared some examples for how exercises for isolations could look like in practice, with some advice or explanation. In this exercise you are going to see in a minute, you will see an exercise filmed by a drone, out of a drone perspective. And there are no cuts having been made, so that you see this is a real situation. The exercise starts with a bouncing of the attacker. And with a bouncing of the attacker, the defender needs to go back to the 6-meter line. By this rule, let's say it this way, we are achieving our aim that the attacker starts with a little advantage so that he has a high speed, the defender reacts out of a defensive position, and we can help the attacker to win this one-on-one duel more easily. And you can also have in mind, if you want to make the exercise more difficult, maybe you change the rules so that the defender has a better start in that one-on-one. You can do this exercise alternately, left and right, or you can start with only one side. You can change distances or starting points of the attacker or defender, Or you can also change the movement of the defender, that he's not moving forth and back, but maybe left and right. The main corrections from my experience are, do you have enough distance for a quick step shot? Because this is solution number one, being dangerous, being able to score a goal. Second correction, which kind of shot do you need to take? A quick step shot, maybe feinting a shot and playing one-on-one, maybe feinting a shot and having a different shot. These are possible corrections. Then after the shot, next point in the corrections is a one-on-one to the strong or to the weak side. If you want to play one-on-one to the weak side, have in mind that you need space behind the defender. Sorry, there's a mistake in my slide. You need to have a space behind the defender for one-on-one to the weak side, because otherwise you would end up in the goal area. And if you are going to the strong side and the second defender is helping, the attackers need to decide whether they should have a breakthrough or a pass to the line. And a pass to the line requires basic skills. What is the angle of the pass? How hard should the pass be? And also precision. This exercise you are going to see is also an exercise which helps to develop defenders, where you could help the defender to guide the attacker to the strong or the weak side so that he takes over the initiative. And also the defender being in the position of the helper needs to take decisions if he should help, if his help is needed or not, or if he's only feinting to help. So many, many points for you in a basic exercise, and how this looks like can be seen in the clip. So bouncing, the defender goes back to the 6 meter line, and then we need quick step shots or one-on-one. And we are practicing alternately, one time the isolation against number 4 defender, and one time the isolation against number 3 defender. A nice one-on-one to the weak side. Quick step shot at the hip. A jump shot. You also saw some corporations. So, and this could be a good introduction or a good start, because we have reduced complexity. There are not many passes in advance. It's reduced to the core. But on the other side, you could improve this exercise with some passes before the one-on-one. This is up to you, but with this organization, this is my experience, we can have many repetitions in a short amount of time. Shooting feint. Good action by the defender. And one last action, a shot. Okay, so this is one possibility, one opportunity, how the training of isolations could look like. And here we have once again the same exercise, but now we have a variation in the defender's movement. He's not moving forth and back, but you see the start of the exercise is not a bouncing, but the attacker, I'll stop the exercise for a second. The attacker is moving. So the left back is starting in this exercise. And you see the left back is moving to his left side. So this means the defender also has to move and follow the attacker's movement. And he's not moving forth and back, but he's moving to his right side. And then the one-on-one starts. And the attacker has to decide out of a new situation, out of a new movement of the defender. Only a slight difference, but this is how it occurs in the match and the game situation as well. Now we can go on with a clip. Only a small variation. But another kind of advantage and more actions where the attackers have to decide breakthrough or cooperation to the line. You have certainly realized that the line player is already out of the target sector. You could also start this exercise with the line player being between the two defenders, moving away first or moving away and coming back with a fake movement. So many options for you as a coach to increase complexity step by step, but to start with a final the core one-on-one after an isolation with different defender movements. Now you will see a different exercise out of the drone perspective in a 3-against-3 situation. And this is a very interesting exercise. And from my experience, this needs a lot of quality for young athletes because their task is not already given that I say you should play the one-on-one or you should play the cooperation in a 2-against-2. But my task for the players is to find a clear one-on-one or a clear 2-against-2, which means with a lot of space and a good opening so that they gain an advantage. So the start of the exercise is a crossing of center back with a line player. You know that opening occurs quite often in modern handball. And after this crossing, the center back is out of the exercise. So we have three attackers, the line player, the left back player, and the right back player. You can do this alternately, left or right. And then the task for the attackers is find a clear start with either a one-on-one or a 2-against-2 and go on after that. And the change of rhythm marks the targeted opening. I don't want situations which occur not on purpose, but I really want targeted openings. So we need precise passes for the starting. We need a long run up. We need to open spaces with blocks in the 2-against-2, and we need correct blocks, so no foul. The line player most of the time starts at the same position. You will see that in the clip, and I guess you will make the same experience when you do this exercise with your players. And the opening for a space for a one-on-one could be by moving away, because in his sector, the attacker will find two defenders close to 6 meters. But in this situation, the attackers most of the time don't make use of the line player moving away. So basic skills for the line player in this exercise, block as well as moving away. And this is important from my point of view. that we do not reduce the line player only to a person moving away out of a sector, but also to cooperate to support the attack by putting correct blocks. So here is how the exercise looks like in reality. Find a clear one-on-one or two against two. Here we have a block and two against two. Very good situation by the left back. A new opening now. So, correction for the line player. He should come out of the sector. Now we have the crossing, center back and line, and center back is out of the game. Here we have a one-on-one to the weak side, which is one, but the defender was in an offensive position. So it was a one-on-one against a weak defense performance and not a very good and very clear one-on-one. Let's look how this exercise goes on. So the defender is going out and we don't have a good block. We don't have a clear start. Yes, they make use of the large space, but it's not a very good opening. So this is what we can improve. Find a clear one-on-one or a clear two against two. Okay, defender in a defensive position. Yes, and here you can see that this is almost the same exercise as we had before, just in a more complex way, with a third defender and a third attacker and another exit. Okay, so another exercise which might help to develop these skills. As I said, a very good opening by a clear two against two. Here, a clear one against one, as some good examples which were taken out by cuts before. You have seen some sequences not being cutted or edited. So another exercise which I want to present is a two against two out of a drone perspective. We have a new sector now to develop flexibility as well, because we have seen in the examples that we might isolate a central or a half defender, number two or number three. So here you can see the start of the exercise, a crossing of right back and right wing with the aim of accelerating the pace of the ball to prepare some passes before, to have an accelerated ball before we start with a one-on-one against number two or number five defender with a supporting movement of the line player. So the wing player can help to keep number two or number five defender at 6 meters. And the center back can play with both, with the left back or the left wing. And remember this situation which we saw in the matches when number two defender is anticipating that isolation and moving out too early. Then the left wing could run back behind number two defender. So we have different possibilities for center back as well. And we have other possible exits like a crossing with a center back. But as I said, this is solution number three, four, or five. let's start with focusing on the one-on-one to do this in a good way. So here we can see the exercise. It's again two against two, only in a different sector. Here we have the one-on-one and the cooperation with the line player. So, and in this sequence, you can also see again, number two defender is moving out and trying to attack the left back very early. And the center back is not looking if the left wing is helping to keep the defender in a defensive position, to keep him at the goal area. But this is something very important, which could help to keep him in a defensive position and to gain an advantage for left back. So here, out of this perspective, we can see that the left wing is waiting in a better position inside, and then the whole exercise looks different. One-on-one, solution with the line player, one-on-one to the weak side, and to the left wing if number two defender is moving out too early. So, last exercise. We have, out of the drone perspective, a three against three. Flexibility is needed in the one-on-one or the two against two. A possible start could be the crossing with the line player or an opening isolation of number two or number five. And yeah, then creativity is needed. The center back learns to distinguish between camouflage actions or real strategy. See the structure of isolations. And yeah, here we see how this looks like in reality. In the first three against three situation, we were focusing on the central sector. Now we have moved to the two central defenders and number five defender. And we are starting with center back crosses with a line player again. So, and now with accelerating the pace, we have a one-on-one in this sector. Here we have the wing inside, or we have a one-on-one against the half defender, number five. So both strategies could be followed, and it stays simple. It's only a one-on-one. Or maybe a clear two against two situation, a clear one. Here we have a clear two against two with a block. And then the players need creativity, flexibility to solve the following up actions. And there we have not a very strict frame of tactical ideas, because this would not fit to young players. They have a frame for the opening action, but for the following up action, from my experience, it's really important to give them freedom, also to give them the opportunity to play according to their strengths, and to find out what they are good at, and also to find out what they have to improve, what they have to practice. So this would be the part of isolations adapted and developing this to younger age categories with some examples of matches and also some ideas. And if you are willing to ask questions, I'd be very happy to get into contact with you, maybe also to get some advice or hint how you practice this, because this is a great opportunity to learn from each other as well. First of all, thank you. And Adrian, I guess there are some questions.
Yes, thank you very much, Jochen, for the presentation and also for the videos, because they were very interesting and revealing, of course. First of all, we wanted to ask you, why is isolation such an important factor in modern handball? And of course, you've presented it during the coaches and referees education week. Now it's also in the youth coaches education week. So why is it so important?
I guess there are two clues to these questions. First, I like that handball is made simple again. If we look at countries like Iceland, which is playing with a lot of isolation in senior handball, or the variations of Portugal and Brazil, almost every country is making use of this. And my first answer would be, we are coming back to a pragmatic way of playing handball, reducing complexity, coming back to basic skills. And the second clue would also be that handball is strongly connected to the factor of time. We see that the different attacks become shorter, that we have after a four warning signal only four passes left, and so this is also a good exit without many passes to be prepared for the attackers if the referees show the four warning signal. And I think these are two clues why we see so many isolations, and the importance of isolations has grown that much.
There's also an interesting question. If somebody is asking if the situations after the isolation is pre-established, one against one cooperation with the line player, or is this left up to the decision or the skill or the experience of the player who is playing on the court in that moment?
I think in top handball, there are many situations established where players know we are good in playing a cross together. And I think there should be, exactly at this point, should be the difference between developing players and playing for success only, to find the right solution very quickly in the matches. And so you sometimes have established the fourth, the fifth, the sixth solution, which are all indicated by numbers or names. And this is important as well, if you're playing in a senior competition, in a very important match, that you don't need three or four attacks until everyone knows that you want to go on with a crossing after an isolation. And in the development of players, I think it's impossible, it's important to focus on the core at the beginning and to give them lots of repetitions where they can really make experience. Which conditions do I need for cooperating with the line? How much space is needed? Is he in a good blocking position? Am I really aiming for a one-on-one, or am I aiming for the cooperation with a line player? Already I have not played the one-on-one for myself convincingly. And there is, for me, the difference between developing players, that they need lots of repetitions without intended solutions, but to gain experience, and senior competitions.
You've said something now about many repetitions in training sessions. And of course, we saw that. Is it difficult to make player focus to learn this type of exercises?
I don't know if I understood the question correctly. Maybe you could repeat it.
Yes. If it's difficult to help players focus because there are many repetitions, exercises start to become quite difficult. So is it difficult to keep the focus for the players throughout the whole training sessions for these exercises, for them to learn and master the technique?
Yes, I think it is. It is really demanding, although we sometimes cannot really imagine that it is demanding for the young players. And I think what is demanding for the players as well is that we sometimes correct them, although they might have been successful, that they might have won a one-on-one or scored a goal, but we still see that there is a lot to improve in the precision or in the quality of their technical performance, and that they learn to distinguish between I have been successful, but there is still something to improve. And that is demanding and difficult for the players as well, and for the coaches really to get clear when to correct the players and when to give them still repetitions where they are learning only without being corrected in every repetition.
Of course, we saw many exercises is one best and others worse, or should all be done at the same time or in different days of the week to try and help the players understand every part of the isolation?
I think there's no exercise best and there's no exercise worst. I think we only have exercises as coaches which we do intentionally or which we do incidentally. And I think if we as coaches have a clear goal, what we want to improve, which exercise is meant maybe for my left back in this session, and which exercise is more focusing on the line player, maybe in this sector or in this sector, then we have a goal, then we have a long-term athlete development in mind. And this is more important than the exercise itself, because as I said, you could also use those exercises for developing defense skills.
Jochen, thank you very much for the presentation. Thank you very much for your answers. Very enlightening, of course. And we will meet once again tomorrow at 13 CEST with another webinar of the IHF Youth Coaches Education Week. Thank you very much for attending. Thank you very much for watching along. Have a nice day. Goodbye.